Now, I want to take us into our message this morning. As we get ready to go there, I want to prepare us with a moment of prayer, but also I want to share a few words. 1 Corinthians 15:3 and 4 says, "For I deliver to you," the Apostle Paul is speaking, and he wants the Corinthians to understand the importance of these words. And so he says, "I deliver to you as of first importance that which I also received, that Christ died for us in accordance with the Scriptures." In other words, the prophecies of the Old Testament predicted this to happen. That Christ died for us for our sins, and that He was buried and He was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scripture. Today what I want to do is I want to take the very best biblical and historical resources, and I want to retell the gospel story, the story of Jesus, of His death and of His resurrection. And as I do that, let's prepare our hearts and minds with a moment of prayer. God, what a gorgeous day. And the truth is, Lord, I'm sure that it was on a day very much like this that the story of Jesus' death and then 3 days later, His resurrection took place. In the midst of a beautiful world that You created, You demonstrated Your most great and beautiful gift of love in the story that we're going to hear this day. Make us sensitive and aware to the great gift that You've given. And take us back in time that we might experience it fresh and new. That we might hear You speak to us the words of love and the gift of love that You have for us. And all God's people said,
Amen.
The morning sun, like this morning, had already been up for several hours over the city of Jerusalem. Pilgrims and visitors were pouring through the city gates. The narrow streets were crowded. There were the aged, stooped with the years, muttering to themselves as they pushed their way through the crowds. And there were little children playing in the streets and calling out with shrill voices. Men and women carried baskets of vegetables and flasks of wine and water bags. And tradesmen had their tools. Over there, underneath the shade of a small tree, stood a donkey attempting to stay out of the bright sunlight. And over there, underneath a narrow canopy, sat a merchant shouting out his wares. Wares for sale! Wares for sale! It wasn't easy to make one's way through the crowded city streets that morning, but it was especially difficult for a procession that started off at the governor's palace. At its head rode a Roman centurion guard who watched the shouting, cheering crowds with eyes of contempt. Before him went four legionnaires, clearing those crowds with curses and with blows. The sunlight glanced off the spears and the helmets of the soldiers as they marched through the city streets. And there was a rhythmic clanking of metal as their shields brushed up against their belts and their swords. Between the two files, a soldier staggered three condemned men, each carrying their own mode of execution, a wooden cross. It was hard to keep up. The soldiers were impatient. They just wanted to get it over with. Left, right, left, right. Come along now, come along. We don't have all day. But the crosses were heavy. And the first of the three victims was at the point of collapse. You see, he had been under severe strain for several days, and more than that, he had been beaten, and he had been scourged. Lashed with a leather whip that contained jagged pieces of bone, stone, and metal, the skin had literally been raked from his back. The sun was hot, and the sweat began to pour down the face of Jesus as he began to sway under the weight of the cross. A group of women followed the procession, some of them sobbing, others praying. Still others moaned in that deep grief that doesn't know what to say or what to do. Some of them had little children by the hands, and they kept saying over and over again, "What harm has he done? Why should they put him to death? He healed my child with a touch of his hand, and this little one could see." other mothers would join in. He brought my child back to life again. What harm is there in that? There were men too. They followed as closely as they could, but some still walked strangely, as if walking was not yet familiar. Still others carried the sticks that they had once used to tap their way through the villages and through the towns. Yes, these men were once blind, and now they were blinded again by their tears. Most of the crowd didn't know what was going on that day. They didn't understand. Most were simply infected by the overpowering zeal of the mob. They shouted at the first of the three victims, the one with that ridiculous-looking crown on his head. And as the blood flowed off the crown and off of his flesh-torn back, the sight of it seemed to inspire frenzy in the mob, and hatred and violence filled the air, and from the back of the crowd began a chant, "Crucify! Crucify! Crucify!" Soon they arrived at Calvary, Golgotha, the hill of the skull. It was a place to be avoided. It was a place where two major highways converged at the city of Jerusalem, and down in the valley below was a place of stench, a place of horror, an ugly place. A place where fires burned constantly and evil-smelling smoke would rise and curl and slither its way across the hill of the skull. Golgotha was the place of public execution. The procession stopped here. But only as the nails were driven in did the shouting start. When the hammering began, a hush fell over the people. Most were shocked and horrified. Even the hardest were silenced. For it's not pleasant to see nails being driven through human flesh. But as soon as Christ had been mounted to his last pulpit, and as soon as that cross had been dropped into its hole, the shouting broke out again. Some who were there had followed him once. They were attracted by the charm of the wonder worker. They had accepted loaves and fishes from his hands, but now they shouted taunts at him. They remembered the words that he had said, and they flung those words back into his face. They taunted him, they laughed, and they mocked him. "Yes, you saved others, but you can't save yourself. Sure, you raised the dead, you gave sight to the blind, you enabled the cripples to leap and walk and praise God in their joy. Oh yeah, you saved others, but you can't save yourself. Miracle man, come on down, we'll believe, just one more miracle, the greatest of them all, come on down. Hey, Mr. Carpenter, we see you got nails in your hand, but where's your hammer? You can't build a temple without a hammer. Come on down, we'll believe." The noise was so great and the fury of the crowd was so intense that very few heard the words that he spoke. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." One of the thieves being crucified with Jesus, drugged and half drunk, began to curse and to mock him. "Can't you see how we suffer? If you're the Son of God, if you're the Christ, if you're the Messiah, then save yourself and us with you." And he continued to curse and to mock Jesus until the other thief on the other cross turned and he cried out in protest, "What has this man done that you curse him so? Do you not fear God since we're under the same condemnation? We're only getting what we deserve. But this man, he's done nothing." And then turning to Jesus, he said, "Lord, remember me when you come into your home." And Jesus, with his face drawn with pain, but his words still kind, said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus, then dropping his head, beheld Mary, his mother, and John, the beloved. And he said, "Son, behold your mother. Mother, behold your son." It was now the sixth hour. An eerie darkness came over the land. The people were frightened. They were horrified. They had no idea what was going on, but all knew that something terrible was about to take place. And so all those who had no real reason for being there quickly scurried back to the safety of the city. Until all that remained were the Roman centurion guards and a few faithful men and women, determined not to leave the side of their Lord in his final hours. They waited. Then in the ninth hour, a cry of victory echoed in the darkness. It is finished. Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? When we're honest with ourselves, we know that we were there and that we helped put Christ there. Because every attitude, every thought, every emotion, every sin that was there 2,000 years ago is present among us today. Every face that was there is here. Every voice that shouted then shouts today. Every sin that nailed him to the cross then nails him to the cross today. Only today it is our sins that spit in his face. It is our sins that beat and that scourge him. It is our sins that, like the crown of thorns, press into his head, and like the nails drive into his hands, and like the spear pierced his side. 2,000 years have passed away, but the centuries have not washed away the blood. Nor have they washed away our need for his forgiveness. Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
And were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? And were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble. While I cry and I tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb?
In Jerusalem, 3 days later, with the hideous death of their Lord still all too fresh on their minds, 3 Jewish women broke into the stillness of the early morning. A week ago, these women would have been singing and shouting, laughing and giggling. But that was a week ago. Now their hearts were dark and they were empty. Haunted by their memories, they had no taste for food. They hadn't slept in 3 days, and the only strength that they had came from the grief that they bore and the hope that they might be able to faithfully serve their Lord one last time. And so Mary Magdalene, Mary mother of James, and Salome gathered up their burial spices, and they began their sorrowful journey to the garden. The garden was a beautiful and a peaceful place, the shade of its olive trees that often brought comfort in the heat of the day. And the grape arbors and flowers and bushes were all well groomed. But on this day, they had not come to behold the garden's beauty. on this day, they had come to enter its tomb. It was newly hand-hewn into the limestone hillside, a fitting place for one such as Jesus, and I'm sure that the women were thankful that Joseph had given it. As they approached the tomb, they had prepared themselves for the possible trouble with the soldiers. They had prepared themselves to behold the tortured and decaying body of their Lord. They'd even discussed how they might try to remove the stone away. But they weren't prepared. How could they be prepared for the sight that they would see? At first, they thought the early morning sun was playing tricks with their eyes. They looked at one another bewildered. They didn't understand why. Why had the stone been rolled away, and where? Where were the soldiers? And the Lord, his body was gone. Well, when Mary Magdalene saw this, thinking that someone had actually stolen the body of her Lord, she lifted her skirt and she went racing back to the disciples. And when she arrived, they tried to settle her down. But she kept rattling on about the stone being rolled and the tomb being empty and the body being gone. Most of the disciples refused to believe her. After all, she was just simply a grief-stricken woman. But Peter and John leapt to their feet and they raced to the tomb. When they arrived, they too were confused by what they saw, because there on the very stone in which Jesus had been laid were the winding sheets they'd wrapped him in, undisturbed. They weren't unwound or even carefully folded. Instead, they lay like a shriveled cocoon with its butterfly released into new life, like a glove with its hand removed. It was as if somebody had taken the body, but they left the clothes. Seeing this, John the younger, the two believed the miracle. Jesus was alive. He was convinced. But Peter? Peter was too old, and he had seen too much. He had seen the spear pierce his master's side. He had watched as that water and that blood gushed forth. He had seen the limp body of his Lord as it was lifted from the cross, and he had seen him as he was laid into the grave, more a mass of meat and blood than man. No, Peter remained unconvinced. With this, the disciples turned to go. Mary had just arrived, weeping uncontrollably. They couldn't talk sense into her. She wouldn't go. She had come to do a job, she said, and she wasn't going to leave until it was finished. And so, unable to convince her to come, Peter and John hurried back to the safety of the house while Mary stayed. Now, all alone, in the quietness of that garden, carefully, Mary stepped closer to the tomb. Bending over, she looked in. And there she saw two angels dressed in white, one at the head and the other at the feet of where Jesus had been laid. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said, "Because they've taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they've laid him." With that, she turned to go, and she beheld Jesus, her master, but lost in her grief, she thought it was the gardener. And he said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek?" And pleading with him, hoping to regain the body of her lost Lord, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, that I might go and take him away." And in reply, he spoke but one word. One word. He said, "Mary. Mary." And when she heard that one word, her name, roll off the lips of her Lord, she turned. And what she knew first with her heart, she now knew with all her being. He was alive. He was alive. This was no gardener. It was Jesus, and he was alive. And she fell to her knees in worship, and she cried out, "Teacher, oh, teacher." She had come to the tomb weeping, but now she could only worship. She had come to the tomb expecting him dead, but she found him walking in the newness of the resurrected life. She had come to the tomb to anoint, but she was anointed. And as she beheld her Lord, her mind must have been filled with all the wonderful things that he had done for her. When no respectable man would be seen with her, he had taken her off the streets and given her life meaning. He had cast out the demons and he had given her love. He had taken the brokenness in her life and he made it whole. It was here, here in the quietness and tranquility of Garden, that Mary Magdalene became the very first to experience the resurrected Christ. But she wasn't the only. The Bible tells us that she was the first, but then came Peter. She was the first, but then came the two on the road to Emmaus. She was the first, but then came the 11 in the upper room. She was the first, but then came the 500. She was the first, but then have come the millions down through the centuries. She was the first, but then can come you and me. Have you met the risen Savior? Has he called out your name? And have you fallen to your knees in worship and cried out, "Teach, oh teach"? He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me a long life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. And I'll tell you, he lives in my heart. On this day and in this place, he lives. And he's standing in the garden of our hearts, calling each of us by name. And hear this, if we choose, you and I can forever sit facing the tombs of our lives, weeping and crying, refusing to listen and believe. But if our hearts are open, we can turn in the direction of his voice, falling to our knees in worship, and we can experience the victory of the resurrected Christ for ourselves. The choice is yours, the choice is mine, but the fact remains. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. And it's exactly because of that that I stand before you today and I deliver to you as a first important that which I also received, that Christ died for us in accordance with the Scripture, and that he was buried and he raised on the third day in accordance with the Scripture. Now, why is that of first importance? Well, I want to bring that answer home by inviting you to return with me back to these two scenes that we just viewed. The two scenes, one of Jesus' death, and secondly of his resurrection. First, in your mind's eye, I want you to travel back with me to the very foot of the cross. Go to the very foot of the cross. Can you see him? Can you see the crown of thorns as they press into his head and the blood as it drips down his cheeks? Can you see the spikes that are driven into his hands and into his feet? Can you see the gaping hole that is in his side from that spear? And can you see his arms spread open wide for you and for me? Can you see him? Now step closer. And in your mind's eye, I want to invite you to step underneath the cross. And I want to invite you to look up. You see that line of blood that is slowly dripping from his finger? Reach up in your mind's eye and allow a drop of that blood to fall into your finger. He did that for you. He did that for me. He did that for us. The Scripture says that while you and I were yet sinners, while we were still enemies of God, Christ died for us. For us. He paid a price that we could not pay. Why? Jesus, I believe, said it best in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world. For God so loved you, and God so loved me that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life." That's why. That's why he was beaten. That's why he was scourged. That's why he was mocked. That's why he was hung upon a cross. So that you and I might know the joy and the victory of abundant life here and eternal life with him, age upon age, world without end. Yeah. Now in your mind's eye, allow 3 days to pass. 3 days. It's early in the morning. Jerusalem streets are still dormant and you're determined. You're determined to finish the job for your master that's been left undone. On your way out of town, you pass through a gate and you enter into a garden. The very garden that your Lord had been buried in. Now, step up to that tomb. All it is a cave that's been dug out in the limestone hillside. That's all it is. Step up to the tomb. The stone's been rolled away. The soldiers that were keeping it guard are nowhere to be found. Now, put your head inside and look around. He's not there. Now turn around. That guy you think is the gardener? That's him. That's Jesus walking in the newness of the resurrected life, and he is calling out your name. Hear this, the living Lord of the universe is calling out your name, and he's waiting for your response. Why? Because he wants you and he wants me to experience his resurrection power. Because in his resurrection power, there is no burden so big that he can't roll it away. There is no sin so great he cannot unwrap it. And there is no hurt so deep that he cannot heal it. There is nothing in his resurrection power that he cannot do. And right now, he is calling out your name. Your name. The scripture says that the only reasonable and rational response when the living God of the universe calls out your name and mine is to fall to our knees in worship and cry out, Teacher, Master, Savior, Lord. How will you respond? How will you respond to the one who died for the forgiveness of your sins? How will you respond to the one who was raised to life so that you might have life both eternal and abundant? How are you going to respond to the one who is calling out your name? How are you going to respond? Let's pray. Choir, if you come up during this time, let's pray. Lord, as I come before you, not speaking for anybody else in this place right now, just speaking for myself as I stand before you even today, after telling your story, I can't figure it all out. Why? Why do you love us so much? Why would you give up your heavenly glory and lay down your life for me and for every single person that's here today and every single person across this world? Why would you do that for our sins? You're the creator of all that is. Lord, I truly don't understand that. I really don't. But I know this. Personally, I know this. It's real. It's powerful. And it's life-changing. Lord, I pray for those in this place that have never experienced an intimate, passionate, growing relationship with you. For those that have never experienced your life-changing forgiveness and love. And for those that have never experienced your grace and victory in their lives. Lord, I pray today that each of us would hear your voice. That we would drop to our knees in worship. And we would cry out, Teacher. Oh, Teacher, I give you my life, my strength, and my all. Just like you did for me. Lord, let all these things be so in your name and for your glory. And all God's people say,
Amen.